এর পরবর্তী অধ্যায়ে আমরা আমাদের মাননীয় অতিথিদেরকে বরণ করে নেব পুষ্পস্তবক দিয়ে। তাদের সম্মাননা জ্ঞাপনের জন্য আমি আমাদের ছাত্রীদেরকে একটু ডেকে নেব। অর্চিতা সরকার, মৌমিতা, জেবা, মধুমিতা একটু মঞ্চের সামনে চলে আসবে। প্রথমে আমি অর্চিতাকে অনুরোধ করব পুষ্পস্তবক দিয়ে সম্মাননা জ্ঞাপন করতে শ্রী কমল থাকারকে। মধুমিতা পুষ্পস্তবক দিয়ে বরণ করে নেবেন আমাদের বিভাগীয় প্রধান শ্রী সুব্রত সাহা মহাশয়কে। মৌমিতা পুষ্পস্তবক দিয়ে সম্মান জ্ঞাপন করবে শ্রী প্রবীর ব্যানার্জি মহাশয়কে। জেবা পুষ্পস্তবক দিয়ে সম্মান জ্ঞাপন করবে শ্রীমতী সুদেষ্ণা সিনহা মহাশয়কে। আনুষ্ঠানিক সম্মান জ্ঞাপনের পর আমরা অনুষ্ঠান আরেকটু এগিয়ে নিয়ে যাব। প্রদীপ চালানোর আগে যেমন সলতে পাকানোর একটা প্রয়োজন হয়, ঠিক তেমনই এই অনুষ্ঠান শুরুর আগে, মূল অনুষ্ঠানে প্রবেশের আগে আমরা আমাদের মাননীয় প্রধান শ্রী সুব্রত সাহা মহাশয়কে কিছু স্বাগত ভাষণ এবং ভূমিকা করার জন্য অনুরোধ জানাচ্ছি।
Representatives of Krishnamurti Foundation of India, Mr. Kamal Thakar, Madam Sudeshna Sinha, and Mr. Prabir Banerjee, faculty members, scholars, teachers, friends, colleagues, and my beloved students. I am delighted to welcome you here today at this state level seminar sponsored by the Rabindra Bharati University. The focal theme identified for this seminar is Educational Philosophy of Jiddu Krishnamurti. As a matter of fact, Jiddu Krishnamurti was born on 11th May 1895 in Mandanapalle in the state of Andhra Pradesh. At his young age, he came in touch with Dr. Annie Besant and other theosophists in Chennai. He was made the head of the Order of the Star, a World Teacher Organization, in 1911, proclaiming Krishnamurti as the vehicle for the world teacher. During his journey, he developed an independent perspective both about the nature of inquiry and about his own role in the pursuit of the good of the society. He established Rishi Valley Education Center in Andhra Pradesh, in the year 1928 to practice his philosophy and thoughts on education. He spent the rest of his life holding dialogues and giving public talks on his observations on the nature of truth, sorrow, freedom, and peace. Krishnamurti's engagement with education is of paramount significance. He put emphasis on the relationship between education and society in terms of transformation of potential of education. He saw the possibilities for radical change through human transformation. His conception of truth as a pathless land is a diverse move for alternative education. Krishnamurti said, education is not only learning from books, memorizing some facts, but also learning how to look, how to listen to what the books are saying, whether they are saying something true or false. He described a new kind of education that would prepare a child to live in society that is economic, that is in economic and moral crisis. For Jiddu Krishnamurti, the real issue of education was to see a child well established in goodness, both outwardly and inwardly, when he leaves the school. The child is to be open, aware, and fearless. I hope today's seminar will focus on key elements of successful programs, methods of teaching, and challenges of Krishnamurti's educational philosophy in the context of other prevailing practices of alternative education in India, like EGS schools in states of Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, Uttar Pradesh, Mavadi in Andhra Pradesh, multi-grade learning centers in Kerala, Shishu Shikha Karmasuchi Kendros in West Bengal, Contract School in Maharashtra, Rajiv Gandhi Sharna Jayantri Pathshalas in Rajasthan. Here, the most critical questions are, what kind of alternative schooling should be designed and offered in our public schools on the basis of Krishnamurti's observation? What should be the alternative programs look like? And how should they be integrated with the regular programs in each community? We know one day seminar is not sufficient to cover judiciously this big canvas of discussion. Still, I believe that the day-round interactions among scholars will surely enlighten future course of action and provoke intended responsibility to the stakeholders. Once again, on behalf of the Department of Education and on my personal behalf, I extend my deep gratitude to Krishnamurti Foundation India for giving us time in spite of their busy schedule. I heartily welcome you all again to this seminar. Thank you.
কৃষ্ণমূর্তি সম্পর্কে, কৃষ্ণমূর্তির শিক্ষা দর্শন সম্পর্কে আমাদের একটা প্রাথমিক ধারণা তৈরি হলো। এই ধারণাকে আরও এগিয়ে নিয়ে যেতে, আরও পোক্ত করতে আমরা অনুরোধ জানাবো শ্রীমতী সুদেশনা সিনহা ম্যামকে তার বিষয়বস্তু উপস্থাপন করতে। উনি মূলত শিক্ষা বিষয়ে কৃষ্ণমূর্তির যে বক্তব্য সেই দিকটি আলোচনার মাধ্যমে উপস্থাপন করবেন।
I'm not going to be able to do that.
Hello, Chair. First of all, I want to thank Ravindra Bharati University and Krishnamurti Foundation of India for giving me this honor to come and share some of his philosophy in education. And today I want to speak on what Kay has questioned. Is there such a thing as right education? My dear friends, what I want to tell you is, here we are not standing really to give you knowledge. We are here to inquire together. It is not a debate that we are going into, a question and answer. Rather, we want to examine together today, this morning. We want to examine together. I want to tell you that we are on the same side of the table, looking at knowledge, looking at what is actually the truth. So we will go beyond the verbal answer by doubting, by questioning. We will try to get a deeper insight into reality. It is not really a method, a problem solving method, a question and answer session. So we start with, we want to think together, is there such a thing as right education? So in the face of brutality, violence, terrorism, corruption in today's world, we want to think together, friends, is there such a thing as right education? If you look at the history of man, for the past 3,000 years, say, let us say for the last 1,000 years, if we take, there has been so many wars. So what could be the reason for this? Does education have a role to play here? Suppose all of us are aliens and we are looking at Earth, right? When we are far away, it is a nice and green glow. As we come closer, let us say we come near the Himalayas, beautiful mountains. But what do we see? People from either side, they are pointing guns at each other. As an alien, I would be surprised, what are they doing? They're spoiling the beauty of the mountains. So we are here really to question, to doubt, and thereby to learn. We are, that as human beings, are we really superior people to other animals? Human beings, we have greater power, greater ability and skill, so-called intelligence, greater IQ, but does it make us more superior? And had it been so, would there be so much of violence, brutality, terrorism? We know the rest. So here, Kay asks us, should we spend time with nature? And what is the role of nature? I mean, how is education related to it? So I'll just read out a quote. Okay, you see, you are not educated to be alone. Do you ever go out for a walk by yourself? It is very important to go out alone, to sit under a tree, not with a book, not with a companion, but by yourself, and observe the falling of a leaf, hear the lapping of the water, the fisherman's song, watch the flight of a bird, and of your own thoughts as they chase each other across the space of your mind. If you are able to be alone and watch these things, then you will discover extraordinary riches which no government can tax, no human agency can corrupt, which can never be destroyed. My dear friends, this is not any literature or poetry I'm talking about. It's about you and me. Have you ever taken a walk down the river? Or how many of us have last seen the sunrise?
or the sunset, which happens every day. All the disorder in society that we see, all the violence, corruption, and all other things that we see is actually disorder in our consciousness. The main source of disorder in consciousness is the human ego. For example, suppose human beings, we have a lot of love inside us. But if you attach ego to it, it becomes possessiveness, attachment. So is our education, does it increase the ego process? Because if you see in nature, man is the only thing which has this ego. So we'll go on to see what more Krishnamurti says about nature. If you could, and we must establish a deep, long, abiding relationship with nature, with the actual trees, the bushes, the flowers, the grass, and the moving clouds, then we would never slaughter another human being for any reason whatsoever. You see, so many things are happening in nature. So we were pondering on. Kay asks us, do we really have a relationship with nature today? And is it really something to got to do with education, our relationship with nature? He says, if you lose touch with nature, you lose touch with humanity. If there's no relationship with nature, then you become a killer. Then you kill baby seals, whales, dolphins, and man, either for gain, for sport, for food, or for knowledge. For knowledge means, in our biology section and in medicine, we dissect animals, he means for that. Then nature is frightened of you, withdrawing its beauty. You may take long walks in the woods or camp in lovely places, but you are a killer and so lose the friendship. You probably are not related to anything, to your wife or your husband. So the next question which we are going to ponder upon together is education only academics? All the encyclopedic knowledge about various subjects, is that education? So here again, for every point we are stressing that we are not really trying to seek an answer. We are pondering about the question, on the question. We learn a lot of English, mathematics, physics, chemistry, history, but is it really education? I'll just show you in my next slide. You can see a mark sheet for university which I have downloaded from the net. You see the student has got marks, some good marks, right? But this mark sheet, when you look at this mark sheet, does this mark sheet ensure he's a good human being? We have mark sheets from so many universities. But this mark sheet, does it ensure that the person is a good human being? Education today is aiming to produce a human being who is intelligent, in our sense, intelligence, knowledgeable, hardworking, efficient, disciplined, smart, successful, and even with good leadership quality. But if one may humbly point out, Adolf Hitler had all these qualities. Adolf Hitler had all these qualities. And we know who Adolf Hitler is and what he has done. Can we really question that did he really get the right kind of education? He says that what we do in education is a child goes to school, he learns, he memorizes a lot of history, arithmetic formula, algebra formula, a lot of other subjects he memorizes. Or when he grows up in university, either medicine or engineering or philosophy, we are all memorizing, and in our brain a stream is formed, and we cannot really step out of the stream. Because the way we are being taught since childhood, we are memorizing different subjects. He questions, Krishnamurti questions, why should we carry all this encyclopedic knowledge and retain it in our brains? He asks, is that education? For example, a surgeon knows human anatomy very well. A computer is becoming more superior than a human brain. But a surgeon who knows a lot of surgery, what kind of a human being is he? Is he sensitive? Nobody asks that question in education. So we are not really criticizing anything. We are here together to question, and thereby this is Krishnamurti's way, that we are questioning. And if you students, if you learn the art of questioning, whatever you see around you, that is a basic thing which will help you to step out of the stream, to be different. The brain's development is lopsided. Means we can see that there are so many tall buildings that human beings have made. In one part, we are very technologically ahead of our times, but we are neglecting the more important psychological part. Who will take the responsibility that we must not only impart knowledge, but also our responsibility is to impart or awaken the wisdom to employ it rightly? Are we paying enough attention to that? That whether we are having the, whether we are generating such people who have the responsibility to impart or awaken the wisdom? A school principal once said to the teachers, he had survived the Nazi camp, and he wrote, I am witness to what no eyes must witness. Gas chambers built by learned engineers. Children poisoned by educated physicians. Infants killed by trained nurses. So I am suspicious of education. My request is, help your students to be human. Your efforts, he met the teachers, your effort must never produce learned monsters, skilled psychopaths, or educated maniacs. Reading, spelling, history, and arithmetic are only important if you can make your students human. So we keep coming back to the first question, that is, what is right education? Krishnamurti says, is it not both the cultivation of a brain that can function excellently in the world and also psychologically understood the whole meaning of existence, the self, the I, the psyche? If every parent and teacher would love the children, so would he allow him to kill others? I'll just go back a little. Would he allow him to kill others or others killing him? Would there be any wars anymore? But we are caught up in our greed, ambitions, expectations from life. So, are we really ready to help the child? You see the next slide. It's a picture of two mother and a child. They're both mother and the child. Inherent human quality is the same, the mother and the child. But the way they're being brought up, they may turn out to be different human beings. We often say that I am a Hindu, so I will celebrate Diwali. Somebody else is a Muslim, so I will celebrate Eid. Or say I'm a Bengali, so I must celebrate Durga Puja. There's nothing wrong in it. But should we fight with each other regarding this? So we come to a very important part, which is conditioning. Conditioning means you see these two mothers, they will bring up the children in different ways. And not only it's mothers, it's of course teachers are also there. So my child is conditioned, right? He grows up with different beliefs. He is exposed to his school, to his schoolmates, to the internet. So from where will his deconditioning start? The most important part of what Krishnamurti talks about education is education starts from the educator, not from the child. He doesn't say not from the child, but this is a very, very important part of Krishnamurti's education. Education starts from the educator. What do you mean by that? Education starts from the educator. I have been to the university. I have got an MSc degree. I have a double PhD. So why should my education start? But how can I teach respect to my child if I do not respect others? This is just one of the examples. When a child sees me smoking outside the house or inside the house, but I tell him that, listen, smoking is not good for your lungs. So education starts from the educator. If you are greedy, angry, dominating, possessive, you will inevitably create a social structure that will bring about further conflict, misery, further destruction. But unfortunately, most of us are not concerned with any of these things. Most of us are concerned with immediate pleasures, immediate success, with everyday living. And if we can get them, we are satisfied. My friends, I just want you to ponder upon this for a little while. If you are greedy, if the educator is himself is greedy, angry, dominating, possessive, leave alone his degrees, you will inevitably create a social structure that will bring about further conflict, further misery, further destruction. So unless we as educators, we are aware of our conditioning, we are aware of our conditioning, and we are also aware that my child, whether I'm a teacher or the parent, my child is also conditioned. So we have to sit together and talk it out. Talk in the sense, it's not a one-way traffic, it should be a dialogue. So we have seen that education, is it really, I've questioned rather, is it really only academics? And we have seen that there has been a lopsided development of the human brain. We are only looking at one part, technological development. We have made huge buildings, etc. But we have totally ignored the psychological part. So Krishnamurti questions, what is a holistic view of education? Holistic view of education, which is not a really narrow view about me, only me and my success and my job, but it is of the whole of humanity. It's not, we have to really delve into deeper. He says that I am the society. If you understand yourself, look within, you are the world. We all have a common, we have common human elements. If I am jealous, the other person can also be jealous. If I am fearful, the other person can also be fearful, whether he stays in America or Russia or whatever. And my holistic view of education, there is one more area to it, holistic view of education, that is, we are stressing too much on specialization, even in higher studies. I'm a surgeon, so I must go to some good university which is ranked as number 2 or 3, and then I must get a degree. But the human consciousness has other avenues as well. It's not only thought-based, it's not only knowledge, but there are other avenues of human consciousness, that we have intrinsic values like awareness, observation, or feeling-based consciousness like joy, fear, jealousy, hatred. And then there are some parts which are beyond thought, which we call as peace, wisdom, meditation, harmony. So the education, does it really lead to the flowering of the entire human consciousness? The education that we should have, it is a question, my dear friend. I must congratulate the students. They are very well behaved, sir. The power went out for 2 times. There was no sign of impatience, no noise, nothing. So we are talking of holistic view of education. What is holistic view of education? I will take it. Questions after this. I said that it is not only in education, it is not only specialization in a certain way, in a certain, say, specialization in medicine or engineering or whatever, but there are other avenues of human consciousness, intrinsic elements like our power of observation, awareness, then there are feelings, our hatred, our jealousy, our love. So, and there is something which is beyond thought, like my wisdom, peace, harmony. So does education really help to bloom the entire consciousness, or is it just one part of consciousness? What should education be? What is right education? Krishnamurti goes on to say, is the result more important than what we are doing? If some of you have doubts or questions, I will definitely take them on, or you can ask right now also. Is the result more important than what we are doing? What do you mean by that? Our present education is rotten because it teaches us to love success and not what we are doing. The result has become more important than the action. The result, what is the final result? What is there in my marks? What, will I get a job after this? So all these things are more important. The universities that are rated, on what basis are they rated? How are the students? What has been the results? What kind of results? But there are students, each child is different. All of you are different. Different in the sense, the basic intrinsic human qualities are the same, but you may have different talents. Each pupil is a different book for a teacher to study. But if we just train you into giving some examinations and then give you a mark sheet, so should we, let us think together, even I don't have all the solutions. We are trying to think together, that is the result more important than what we are doing? So we come back to the first question. Is there such a thing as right education? We have asked several questions. Should it be only academic? Should have a relationship with nature? How does it help? How is it related to education? Should the brain only be trained to improve in technology and compete with the computer, or is there a psychological part also? And then of course, educating the educator, there is something called conditioning. The child, as he grows up, he faces different people, different belief systems, both the parent as well as the child. So does education have a role to play here? So since it is a lopsided kind of development happening, then what is a holistic view of education? What are we trying to stress at? Is it the result? Or is it the person, the child? So we are here to examine together, is there such a thing as right education? Here I am going to read out what K. Krishnamurti said about education, about right education. He says, I am going to ask you something. Why are you being educated? Do you understand my question? Your parents send you to school. You attend classes, you learn mathematics, you learn geography, you learn history. Why? Have you ever asked why you want to be educated? What is the point of you passing examinations and getting degrees? Is it to get married? To get a job and settle down in life? As millions and millions of people do? Is that what you're going to do? Is that the meaning of education? Do you understand what I'm talking about? Are you being educated to conform, to fit into society and into the culture, to fit into the stream of social and economic activity, to be sucked into that vast stream and so be destroyed? See that the mind is never sucked into that stream, so that with such a mind you can be an entirely different human being with a different quality of life. Real education means that in human mind, your mind and my mind, not only is capable of being excellent in mathematics, geography, history, but also can never under any circumstances be drawn into that stream of the society. So we come back to our last question. Is there such a thing as right education? Thank you. It was nice being here, but if you have some questions regarding this, you can ask. My friends there will also answer the questions.
Vivekananda, Rabindranath, all is in the same way talking about that. what Vivekananda said. You may be the most intellectual people the world has ever seen, yet you cannot reach the God. It is the heart which takes you to the highest place. Cultivate your heart through the heart of the Lord speaks. Here is the point. Here is the key concept which we should concentrate. Actually, what we are talking about, why, how nature plays a very important role in our development. How? This is the question. Everybody is talking about we have to be educated in the midst of nature, because true nature infiltrates in our mind through the enjoyment in contact with nature. But how? I am just trying to give a small explanation about that. That is, we are very much anxious and concerned about our conscious mind, our cognitive domain. We don't know exactly how our affective domain functions, how a child's affective domain develops. We often use the word intuition. What is intuition? Intuition means perceiving something through your unconscious mind. How our unconscious mind develops? Jung told that is the archetype, the structure of our unconscious mind, from where the true knowledge begins. That's why the quotation was fabulous, and the appeal of the quotation that no book, no teacher can teach you. You can learn from yourself. It is an endless process. It is a fascinating process. Out of when you can learn from yourself, out of that learning, the wisdom comes. What is the meaning of that? The meaning of that, that how you develop your unconscious mind, how the structure of your unconscious mind, that is the archetype, develops. That is the most important aspect of human knowledge, human civilization. That means we exactly don't know how our affective domain works, from where our emotions come, how we feel in a different manner. Actually, it depends on the structure of our unconscious mind. And here plays the role of sense organs. In our education system, if we fail to develop the learners, we fail to give them the proper training to use their sense organs. They have eyes. They can see, but they couldn't observe. We have ears, but we listen. But we have to listen through our eyes. This is the training of sense organ actually comes from the nature. Communion with nature, a child's sense organs training is completed, and it actually develops the archetype of the learner's unconscious mind, and which is the basic of all knowledge, which is the basic of all source of knowledge. That's how I feel, and here lies the success of Krishnamurti. And the Diller in the report, it is also reflected that education doesn't mean preparing the people to take their place in the knowledge economy. It is something beyond that. Beyond what? Beyond these things. We have to cultivate the positive energy, positive emotions among the learner. Otherwise, we cannot know how to live together. This is the basic concern of the civilization. This is the basic concern of the world today. So we don't know how to live together. So how to live together, how to develop our society, how to develop our human civilization, all depends on one thing, that is the development of proper development of the learner's affective domain. And we have to think about that, and no Western philosophy can help us in this regard. Only Indian education philosophy can give a basic knowledge, basic source of that training from where a teacher can help to develop the affective domain of the learner, so that the learner's sense organ works perfectly that the learner's emotions are not negative, all are positive and all are constructive. That is my point of view, and we have to know how our unconscious mind operates, how our unconscious mind develops. This is a discipline where psychological knowledge and Krishnamurti's philosophy and other philosophies come together and create a new domain of knowledge. That's my observation. Thank you.
It is our pleasure that Professor Hitendra Kumar Patel, Professor of History, and he is now the head of the Adult and Education and Continuing Center. He is with us and he is willing to have a kind of discussion with all the audience present here. Over to Professor Patel.
I thank you, Professor Subrata Shaha, for giving me this opportunity. I was listening very patiently and with a great joy what the speaker, speaker was from Sinha.
Sudeshna
Sinha. I am here to share two or three things in a very simple manner. One is that, to me, Krishnamurti is probably the most original and most important thinker as far as education is concerned in India, in my view. I'm not a knowledgeable person that way, but what I have experienced while reading him, I have experienced that man had actually touched upon the most important and crucial element of existence. His remarks about observation, why should we observe, why should we try to come out of the mundaneness of life, what we call life, this mundane life has to be understood first, and then only we can enter into what we can, what he thought can be an endless joy of living. I came into contact with some of the minds who were influenced by Hindu Krishnamurti 10 years back, and then that point onwards, I'm under the spell of that man. Even if I have not studied him thoroughly, I didn't have the opportunity, but I have a wish that Hindu Krishnamurti should be understood in Indian academia in a way in which every discipline can be benefited by that. And how that can be, that is the question I am trying to negotiate with. People say that Hindu Krishnamurti is fine, his ideas are very good, and it sounds so good. I mean, Rajesh was very clearly interpreting his ideas, bringing Jung and all, to find out how subconscious faculties can be developed for a holistic kind of what he calls knowledge or understanding. And he comes to the conclusion that only an Indian philosophy of education can be of much help. I do not see a kind of binary between West and East that way, because there are people in West also who are realizing the importance of this whole thing. My basic question is, how to get it popular? How can a historian learn from the ideas of Krishnamurti? People say that, okay, it sounds good, but it is basically elitist. And they give the example that in the Krishnamurti institutions are the places where only very affluent class people can go and get their child admitted or the study there. I mean, and they have reasons for saying that. I'm not going into that detail because there are things which are institutional and there are things which we may not understand from outside. But at least at the academic level, how Krishnamurti can be made useful for us, for example, historian. We have forgotten people who really and originally thought about what education is. What education is. Education is not merely an opportunity to get the right kind of what is called tools for getting married, as the speaker was referring to, getting married and getting settled in a life. It is not that. Education was conceived as something which opens up the possibility of knowing the world and knowing yourself in the process. And when she was referring to we are the world and I am the society, we are basically positing the ideas of Krishnamurti in a way in which all the contradictions around which our modern education system is created falls down. I think history has to learn from Krishnamurti how to see things or understand things without bringing in the contradiction into the plane all the time. We all are unhappy and we all are ignorant and we all are trying to become powerful, and the chaos it creates in the process has to create a society in which things like Bluewell and other kind of things are going to hit us. Whether we like it or not, the roots of this entire crisis is in the understanding of education which we have created in the modern time. So my basic concern is how to come out of it. For knowledgeable people from Krishnamurti Foundation, there must be, I must say, I'm very grateful to Krishnamurti Foundation India that it has taken the trouble of coming to Prabhupada Bharati, and I wish someday our own department or some other department will bring them here. I think this is a very good initiative in schools, in colleges, in universities. You people have to go and reach out to those people who are really interested in getting interested in knowledgeable. But they are unable to understand how this can be useful and how this can be made useful in the given structural existence they have. I think we must try to understand that we need some resources to survive in society. And those resources are dependent on certain kind of conditionalities which require certain kind of education. So our idea may be right, but it is not useful to live in self-doubt. It is not becoming useful for the people who actually wants something from education. That is one thing. So let us try to use innovative and original thoughts of Krishnamurti in such a way that it can be linked to the way in which people can understand. And for that, I think we all have to work together. Otherwise, even the greatest ideas get lost in the process. So that is where I think we need to work, number one. And number two is that there are things which were understandable in those days when Krishnamurti was actually speaking. And he was speaking to an enlightened audience most of the time. So things were catchable, what I call catchable. But today, I may use Harari's connotations. Harari has written a wonderful book on how we are getting lost in this knowledge and other things. In this age, we need a new vocabulary. I reiterate on this point that it's holistic education understand it. So, can we think of a vocabulary which can make sense to people in 2017? And for that, we all have to make a new kind of effort. So I bow before the wisdom and the ideas of the profoundness of Krishnamurti, but I wish some of us at least try to make things more understandable, because we ultimately want all of us to get benefited by his ideas. And therefore, I really request humbly that we need to do further. We need to do somehow. And how that can be done, you have to think. And in all that process, the academic world should come forward to make certain kinds of contributions towards that. Needless to say, I am overwhelmed whenever I listen one or two quotes. I request all of you to spare some hours for Krishnamurti. His conversation with Bow is quite popular, it is available. You try to read that. His conversation with Bow, which opens up very different kind of things to academic world. And the best Western mind scientists have been influenced by that, and we keep reading that. So, all my students should read Krishnamurti themselves. And they can start their own dialogue. Even if you are not able to understand everything of that, but I think if you give 2 days to Krishnamurti, you will pick up your own entry point to the great ideas of Krishnamurti. A new meaning of tradition will come up to you. A new meaning of a teacher comes to you. A new meaning of memory comes to you. And I invite all the students to read Krishnamurti, of all the subjects, not only education, all the subjects. That is what I wanted to share. Thank you very much.
I may not be a student of history, but I have my own history of my personal life, like my life all of you. So human beings may have got country-specific history, and it is a factual, actually true, that the historicity of a country differs from one country to another. It is true. But one thing is common, universal. Human beings have a long history of fear, anxiety, aggression, violence, and that history goes on since a millennium or more, it has been going on right at this moment. So, so actually, Krishnamurti. And we have the history of power, for example.